Server auditing for Azure SQL Database is something a lot of folks have been using for a long time. Well, in this episode, you'll learn all about how we've redesigned the architecture so you can be more reliable, more highly available, and more efficient. Learn all about it, including some of the things you should keep in mind with these changes this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Sravnani, who is no stranger to Data Exposed. So welcome back to the show, Sravnani.
Thanks, Anna. Thanks for having me again.
It's great to have you back. Today, we're going to be, for folks who don't know, Sravnani is a PM focused on SQL in the security space. So we're really excited to have you on the show today because we're going to be talking about the server audit redesign for Azure SQL Database. And before we get into all the details of that, like, I'd love to understand from your side, like, let's level set, what is server audit? Where is it supported? And then, you know, we can get into why the change.
Sure, Anna. So auditing is a feature that is there since 2008, starting with the SQL Server on-prem box product. And now we expanded it through all SQL flavors, like we support for Azure SQL Database, Hyperscale, Synapse Analytics, Synapse Workspaces, and even for SQL Managed Instance. And when it comes to auditing, when it comes to cloud, we have some kind of internal auditing and then customer-facing auditing. And for customer-facing audit, for all flavors of SQL, like SQL Server, Managed Instance, and Azure SQL Database, we have something called Server Audit and Database Level Audit. So server audit is something that is enabled at the server level and captures the data for all databases in your server. And then database audit, as the name indicates, it's enabled at the database level and it captures all the configured events for a given database. However, today's change that we are going to talk about, the server audit redesign, is something that is applicable only for your Azure SQL Database and only for the server audit. So the remaining customer-facing audits that we have today, they are not affected and they continue to work as it is.
Got it.
So what is this audit re-architecture and why we have to do it, right? So like I said, for Azure SQL Database, we support server-level audit and database-level audit, which can be enabled from the portal. So when customers enable auditing from the portal, most of the times they either enable server-level audit because it just captures the data for all your databases. And if you need to do any kind of customization, they enable it at the database level. And most of the times it is just done from the portal, which is the default audit. And then they configure it to storage accounts or log analytics or event hubs. So all these years, what is happening is though customers enable server level audit for Azure SQL Database, logically it is not a real server audit. So when it comes to SQL Server and SQL MI, when I say server audit, the auditing is enabled at the server level. And for auditing, we always use extended events to capture the data. So when you enable at the server level, what happens is we start an extended event session, which runs in the master database, which is at the server level. And it captures all the required events for all databases in that specific SQL instance. However, when it comes to Azure SQL Database, the way it was designed, when the feature was released, it was assumed that it was for a database, right? Azure SQL Database, we didn't expect that it will have like hundreds of databases, elastic pools. It is growing like crazy, right? So initially it was designed like a database audit. So even though if customer enables a server audit, under the covers, what happens is we enable audit at each database, which means, for example, if I have 100 databases, I am going to start 100 extended event sessions for each database. So each database will have its own extended event session running, and that will collect the data and write to the audit logs. So that is what is happening for Azure SQL Database till today, right? So with this new design, we are actually switching really from the database audit to the server audit. So when it comes to SQL like when it when you compare it with SQL managed instance and SQL server, that is how it works. So if you enable server level audit, there is an auditing session that runs in your master database, which collects all the data, writes to the target. And if you enable a database level audit, it captures the events at the database level. There is an extended event session that runs in your database and writes the data to the audit file or the target. So we are switching the behavior for Azure SQL Database also in alignment with the SQL Server and SQL MI. So going forward, if customer enables a server level audit, there is going to be only one extended event session, which is going to capture this data and write to the target. So if you see in this image, you can see that earlier the behavior is I have audit session running in each and every database. Right. And with the new architecture, there will be only one audit session that is running in your master database. And like I said, this is how it works today for SQL Server and MI. This was only for SQL Database. It was designed that way. And now we are aligning this model with the SQL Server and SQL Managed Instance. And why are we doing this, right? So this improvement is going to help us to improve the compliance, high availability, reliability, the feature parity, and any kind of future enhancements that we would like to do. This enhancement is going to help us really. Like, for example, when it comes to performance, you can imagine like when you have 100 databases, if you have 100 extended event sessions running versus one extended event session running, the amount of load that you can generate on CPU, you can compare 100 versus 1. So during our test, we see that it is really, the performance is way better than before. And also the amount of memory that we allocate for the extended event sessions is also reduced to like more than 50 times. So, yeah, that is the performance improvement. And then also it is also helping us to improve the availability. So if you imagine like you have a server with 100 databases, and let's say there is a failover that happens. When the failover happens, you have to restart all the audit sessions for all the 100 databases. So we did had some issues in the past where the audit sessions might take time to come up. There might be some kind of deadlocks during the failover because you have so many sessions running, things like that. So with the new architecture, we are going to minimize or nullify all these issues that we have seen in the past. So like I said, it will also help us to achieve feature parity, because you can now see that it is aligned with SQL Server and SQL MI. For example, one of the feature parity gap we have today is that we don't support server level action groups for Azure SQL Database, because logically there is no server level right. audit. But with this change, we will be able to support server level action groups. And this server level action groups is like a common ask from many customers like banking sectors, because they do have like a common template that they have to collect for all databases. And if the server level action groups are not supported, they cannot meet some of their compliance requirements. So that is how this is helping us to meet some, to address some of the feature parity gaps that we have between SQL Server and SQL Database. So it is also along with this redesign, we have also done some enhancements in multiple areas. Like I said, we are now handling the extended events in a better possible way in order to avoid any kind of event losses. So with that, it increases the reliability of the feature. So that's what.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, I think this on the whole seems very positive. I think folks will be excited to hear that we're kind of increasing the parity, increasing the reliability, the high availability, compliance, all of it. So that's great. You know, of course, people are going to ask, okay, like now we're moving to this new thing. I was using the old version. What are the gotchas or the things folks should know as they move from the previous architecture to this new architecture?
That's a great question, Anna. So this change, customers doesn't have to do anything. The change will be implemented from the backend through the trains, and the deployment we will be doing region wise. And what we are doing is we are notifying all customers whenever we are switching them from the old architecture to the new architecture. we will be sending them a notification email with all the changes details. And though there is no change in the functionality, like I said, the audit logs will just continue to work. We just switched from the old to the new architecture. Customers are not even aware of it. It just changes on the fly. There is nothing that needs to be done from the customer side. However, though there is no change in the functionality, there is one change that happens if customers are collecting the data to storage accounts. So if customer have a target, which is storage account, where they have a server audit that is configured. So now what happens is going forward, for example, if customer have a database called test, earlier when you enable server audit, there is different folders created for each database. So all audit logs for test database are stored in test folder in your storage container. And for adventure works, there is a folder called adventure works. So like that, each database has its own folder created in the storage account, because we were actually running multiple extended event sessions and each session has its own target. However, with this change, now all data will be returned to a single folder, which is master folder. So if I have like 10 databases, all the data is now going to master folder inside my storage container. And now customers have to query it in a different way. So this is definitely called a breaking change, because customers can have T-SQL scripts or partial scripts or some kind of .NET scripts that are running, which captures these audit, which reviews these audit logs. So this is a breaking change. So what we have done is we are not pushing the change by forcefully. That is why we are deploying this change region-wise. And like I mentioned, this change is for good. It has a lot of advantages. However, we have to adapt some of these breaking changes as well. So we already spoke to multiple customers one-to-one, because based on the telemetry, we knew that these customers are reviewing the audit logs, and we explained them how to change their scripts. Fortunately, most of the customers are using T-SQL or partial, where they are going to change the folder structures. So with this change, three issues that I would like to quickly mention, because most of the customers were asking those questions. One, now that we are writing everything into the master folder, the way they query the logs is going to change. Like in this slide, it is mentioned, right? Instead of database name, now they have to mention the folder name as master and then provide database name in the where clause. So now if I have 100 databases, all data is sitting in the same folder and it's going to take long time, right? So for this, we have introduced something called time-based filters, which is the like a V2 version of the existing TVF, that is FN get audit file V2. And this function accepts a time range. So earlier, for example, if I have to filter the audit logs for last 2 hours, what I have to do is you have to load the audit logs for the entire day into the memory, and then you do the filtering in memory. So this really takes a lot of time. But with this new function, you can specify the start time and end time in the function itself, which will help you to filter the files at the storage account itself. So there is 2 levels of filter that happens. At the storage level, we filter the logs. We only load the last 2 hours of data into the memory. Then once it is loaded in memory, then we filter for a specific database. So there is 2 levels of filtering that it happens. So with this, what we have seen based on our testing is this time-based filtering yields greater results. And though it's taking time, now customers can query the audit logs more easily. So this is one of the issues they were asking, like how do we query? It can take longer time. So customers can start using this time-based filtering, which will help them to query the logs faster. And the second issue that most of them were asking is about the permissions, right? Because earlier, since each database has its own folder, the audit logs are isolated. But now if everything is written to the master folder, so they whoever has access, they will have access to all the audit logs. So for this, right now, we do not have any solution yet. We will look into it and see how can we isolate these permissions. But technically, if you're speaking, if you have to really isolate at the database level, then you should use database audit, not the server audit. Server audit is meant for the server. So if you're enabling at the server level, it's a common set of activities that are captured. It is written to a common target. So there is no way you can isolate it because it is at the server level. So what we advise is if customer needs like a database isolation, then they should ideally switch from server level to database level auditing. And again, that can be easily done from the portal itself. They can just disable the server audit and enable the database audit from the portal. So that will help them to isolate their audit logs, and the database audit will continue to work as it is, and it will write in its own folder. So that is another issue that most of the customers were asking. And the third one is like some of the customers, they are receiving the notifications, but sometimes the subscription owners and the customers are different. So that is why we are going to release a blog as well. And then, like I said, since we are implementing region-wise, we will also try to share the documentation, like so far what is done and when are we expecting to complete this deployment worldwide. And we want to support hybrid mode for some time so that in case, like most of the customers are positive about this change and they are ready to adopt. But in case if any customer has any blockage, like they cannot switch to this new architecture immediately due to some reason, like maybe some kind of scripts which they cannot update immediately, we are always help them by keeping them to old architecture for some time and then allow them to make all the changes, and then we can switch them back to the new architectures. Yeah.
Got it.
So
it makes sense.
Supporting this hybrid mode for some time.
Awesome. Got it. Yeah. Sravnani, we're about out of time. Any final tips and tricks you have for folks who might be just getting started?
Like I said, start using this the new functionality, this time-based filtering. If you see in my screen, it has like two, the start time and end time, which are the two new parameters that we introduced. It is not only applicable for the new architecture, they can even use it for the old architecture. So they can start using this functionality. It is very faster compared to the old TVF. And along with this, so right now, I also want to mention this time-based filtering is currently available only for Azure SQL Database. We started supporting it immediately because we started the deployments for the server redesign for the Azure SQL. However, this functionality will be soon available for SQL Server and SQL MI as well.
Awesome. Cool. That's great to know. Sravnani, thanks so much for coming on the show. Personally, I learned a lot. For our viewers, we're going to put some links in the description so you can learn more about the documentation, learn more about the breaking changes and anything you need to know, including all the benefits you get with the new server audit redesign. Again, Sravnani, thanks so much for coming on the show. If you like this episode, go ahead and leave it a like, leave us a comment and let us know what you think. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.